Collins ELT Readers, in association with The Amazing People Club. Audio copyright HarperCollins Publishers Limited, 2014. Amazing Scientists, Level 4.
Alessandro Volta, the man who invented the battery.
Before electricity, people lived half their lives in darkness. We relied on horses for transport. The basic ingredients had been available for over 2,000 years, so why did it take us so long to learn to use the power of electricity? On the 18th of February, 1745, I was born into a wealthy family in Como in northern Italy. Both my parents, my mother, Donna Maddalena, and my father, Filippo, came from high-class Catholic families. I was a very introverted child, and even by the age of 4, I wasn't speaking. My family thought that I was unable to speak, that I lacked the intelligence to do so. Despite this, I was sent to the local Catholic school, run by priests, and by the time I was 7, I had surprised everybody. Far from being stupid, I was really quite clever. At this time, my father died, which affected me deeply, and I became even quieter and less communicative. My uncle, who took over the responsibility for my education and the teachers at school, wanted me to become a priest. This had been the career of other members of my family, and it seemed suitable for me too. I, however, was not interested in joining the church, and I refused. My family's second career choice for me was law. I wasn't very keen on becoming a lawyer either. When I was 15, I started studying natural philosophy at school. I was a good student, and I also liked reading and studying languages, something I appeared to be talented in, because I learned to speak Latin, French, English, Dutch, Spanish, Russian, and Greek. I liked writing poetry too. My real interests, however, were physics and chemistry. I was fascinated by the way things worked, and I read all the science books I could find, especially if they were about electricity, which I was really interested in. In 1763, when I was 18, I started to write letters to a French physicist who was also a priest, called Jean-Antoine Nollet. Nollet had been doing experiments with electricity. In 1748, he had invented the electroscope, a machine that could find whether there was an electric charge present in something or not. He was also fond of demonstrating the results of his research, and his lectures soon became popular. One spectacular demonstration was done in front of King Louis XV at the Palace of Versailles in France. Nollet managed to pass an electrical charge through 180 people. For this demonstration, he used 180 soldiers and something called a Leyden jar. This was an ordinary glass jar which was lined with paper-thin sheets of tin, a metal, and three-quarters filled with water. At the top of the jar there was a cork through which passed a thin metal wire. The wire was attached to a metal chain outside the jar to allow the electrical charge to pass into the jar. Nollet asked the soldiers to stand in an open circle and hold hands. When he told them to, the first and last soldier each touched the jar, completing the circle. The electricity passed through each soldier at the same time, with the result that all 180 soldiers jumped into the air simultaneously. The king was highly amused by this and made Nollet repeat the demonstration using priests. Nollet did many other demonstrations and experiments, and news of his work spread throughout the scientific community. I had decided not to go to university to study when I left school. At this stage, I had not yet started doing my own experiments, and I really wanted to learn as much as I could from Nolle. He later became the first professor of experimental physics at the University of Paris. I was also in contact with Professor Giovanni Battista Beccaria of the University of Turin, and I sent him a paper I wrote in Latin called On the Attractive Force of Electric Fire. Later, in 1769, it was published. I started doing my own experiments. This was a slow process, and I made many mistakes. I also learnt a great deal, and in 1774, when I was 29, I became Professor of Physics at the Royal School in Como. 10 years previously, a Swedish physicist called Johan Wilke had invented a generator which produced static electricity. In 1775, I invented an improved version of his generator called the electrophorus. My invention was more useful because it was able to produce a larger amount of static electricity and to produce it continuously. Later, it was developed so that it could store electricity. In 1777, I went to Switzerland and met with a physicist and geologist called H.B. de Saussure, who helped me develop my ideas, and I continued my research. I was looking at atmospheric electricity and at the instruments Saussure had developed to measure it. I was able to alter his instruments to make them more accurate, so that electrical tension, as it was known, could be measured. In 1881, many years after my death, the unit of measurement was named the volt in my honour. As more people in the science community noticed my work, more opportunities became available to me. The next year, my attention turned to the chemistry of gases, and in 1778, I discovered a dangerous gas which was later called methane. One day when I was on holiday in a boat on a lake, I saw some bubbles coming up through the water. The air above the bubbles smelt horrible, and naturally, I was curious to discover what it was. I managed to get some of the bad-smelling air back to my laboratory and found that it was inflammable. That is, that it burnt easily. As the gas had come from beneath the ground, I continued my research. It was discovered that methane was a gas that was present in mines, and because of its inflammable nature, it was extremely dangerous. In 1779, I moved to Pavia in northern Italy, where I became professor of experimental physics at the university. 6 years later, I became rector, the head of the university, but I continued to do research. Electricity was still the subject I thought most about. Each summer in our region, there were giant thunderstorms. I was fascinated by the noise of thunder and sparks of lightning, and wondered if we could capture the power I was seeing and use it. Meanwhile, I started looking at frogs. In 1791, an Italian physicist and medical doctor called Luigi Galvani had been working on a theory he called animal electricity.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.